So good morning everyone. Today I will look into some example and of how you can apply this signal processing techniques in biomedical signals. So this study has been conducted by Bikas, your TA, for his PhD research. So I will be presenting a part of part of his research, so that you can understand how you can correlate the lab classes with your this practical thing, and you can go forward for your further research and all these things, right? So what Kaz is doing is trying to understand the effect of coffee, especially this caffeinated coffee, on cardiac physiology and cognition. Because he's mainly working on the cardiac physiology, the cognition work was carried out by one of my previous M.Tech students, Kishore Taraftar. Okay, so currently he is in IIT Bombay doing his PhD. So, if you see, a food component like coffee, they consist of caffeine, right? And hence it is called decaffeinated coffee. Nowadays, you will find that the various coffee manufacturers, they are also producing or marketing decaf coffee. What is decaf? Decaf means decaffeinated. Okay, decaffeinated means the coffee from where the caffeine has been extracted and there are no caffeine present within the coffee. Okay, so those coffee are regarded as decaf coffee. Okay, and they are gaining more importance in the current day world due to several reasons. Okay. So let's see the background why we are interested to work in this area. Okay. So if you consider coffee, it is most widely used beverage which is globally used. Okay. Now if you see, most of us, when we get up from the bed, we either take tea or coffee. Okay, we either take tea or coffee. Now once we take tea and coffee, what we do is that it has been found out that in one cup of coffee we have 28.5 mg of caffeine. Okay, so talking about tea and coffee, we don't only take it when we get up from the bed, we also take these beverages when we are relaxing with our friends. Okay, suppose you want to discuss something with your friend, you go to a Nescafe or Cafe Coffee Day and have a cup of coffee and have chit chat with your friends to discuss various things, starting from science to whatever you can talk about, your personal life things, to your problems, whether official problem or family problem, whatever you discuss with your family and friends over a cup of coffee, right? Now, if you, as I said, each cup of coffee, what you take, it consists of 28.5 mg of caffeine. Okay. Now, this caffeine, it is a neurological stimulant. Okay, it is a neurological stimulant. Okay, and it temporarily boosts the energy, mood, and alertness of a human person. Okay, so because of this reason, since the caffeine, it has got neurological effect and it is present either in tea and or coffee. What happens during exams? You will find many of the Indian moms, they would ask their words, beta chai ya coffee loge kya, during the examination, right? So what happens during the examination? Many a time you get tensed, right? Now when you get tensed or you are stressed up, during that condition, if you take the caffeine, it will give you temporary boost in the energy, mood and alertness, and when you will be studying, you will be able to remember more of the content. Okay, so this is the science behind taking coffee or tea, or the mother offering the coffee or tea during the exams schedules. Okay, I hope many of you have faced on you have just your mom has asked for caffeine, this coffee or tea before the exams, right? So this is a very common practice, right? So though it is a neurological effect, a neurological stimulant, if you see any of the body organs like liver, skin, stomach, kidney, whatever organ you talk about, the caffeine has impacts on those other organs, because all these organs, who controls them? The neurological system, it controls them. Okay, so what do you have in neurological system? In the neurological system, you have brain or spinal cord. Okay, so brain or spinal cord, right? Now, since caffeine is activating the brain centers and the spinal cord centers, since this neurological system of our body, it is being affected, they are also affecting these other body organs like liver, skin, stomach, kidney. One of what do you call? I presented this paper in one of the conferences, and one of the people say, can it alter the secretion of the hormones? Definitely yes, because whatever the organ you talk about, those hormonal systems, they are also controlled by the neurological system of our body. Okay, they are also being innervated with the nervous system. So definitely yes, so it can also affect the balance of hormones within the human body. Okay, so if you look into the effect of caffeine onto the human body, so mostly studied areas are cardiac system and cognitive behavior. Okay, cardiac system, it is associated with the heart, it may be blood pressure. Okay, it may be your heart rate variability. Okay, it may be the perfusion of the blood into the myocardial muscles, and so on. Okay, and cognitive behavior, it is associated with the brain function. Okay, so people have tried to understand how the caffeine can affect the cognitive perception or the cardiological system. However, most of the studies which have been conducted, they are either observational or clinical in nature. So what do you mean by observational? Observational means whether there is an increase in the body blood pressure or not, whether there is an increase in the body temperature or not. So whatever the physical parameters you can think about, whether there is an increase in the SpO2 or not. So all these parameters, they are called observational. You are, after having a cup of coffee, you are just looking into whether the various physiological parameters like BP, temperature and all these things, they are increasing or decreasing. Okay, And second thing is the clinical. What do you mean by clinical? Say, for example, when we are talking about the cardiac system, the most common thing is the ECG. It is the simplest way to understand the cardiac system. Okay. So what is ECG? It is a graphical representation of the electrical activity of the heart, and by analyzing that, you can be able to understand whether your cardiological system they are functioning properly or not. So suppose if anyone in your house, those who are elderly persons or geriatric persons, they face some kind of what you call dizziness or say some chest pain or something, if you take them to the hospital, the doctor will first check the ECG. It is the one of the most what you call common tests which have been carried out in the hospitals. Why they perform? Because in the elderly persons, what happens is that there are higher chances of cardiac malfunctioning, and if there are any malfunctioning of the cardiac system, the ECG will provide you the information from there. Now, what do they see? If you see the doctors, cardiologists, they do not use any AI's based system or something, right? What they do? They will just look into the ECG pattern of the signal, right? Now, what they see? So this is PQ. RST. Now you must have studied the physiology or the electrical activity of the heart in the anatomy physiology class, right? Now what do they see? What is the, is there any changes in the PR interval? Are there any changes in the QRS complex? Okay. Is there any changes in the amplitude or the duration of the P wave? Are there any changes in the amplitude or the duration of the T wave? Okay. Whether there are any changes in the QRS complex and all these things. So clinically, they look into these parameters. Okay. So if you look over here, so mainly, as I said, the effect of caffeine on the physiological system, especially the cardiac system and the cognitive behavior, the analysis is are either based on observation or just the clinical analysis. Okay. There are very few number of studies who have employed signal processing based approach to analyze the effect of the coffee on the different functioning of the either the heart or the cognitive or the brain or the, any other physiological systems. Okay. Based on that, what we hypothesized is that since the caffeine from the coffee, it is affecting the nervous system. Okay. So it can have effect for both the cognitive performance, that means the brain, and the cardiological system. So this is the flow chart how it affects the different organs. The first thing is you have the nervous system. So the nervous system, they can be categorized either as central nervous system or the peripheral nervous system. In the central nervous system, you have brain and spinal cord. Okay. Most of the analysis of the central nervous system, they are being carried out by understanding the brain physiology. You will not find many paper where this effect of different stimulants on the spinal cord activity has been found. This is because it is difficult to access the spinal cord. Okay. It is difficult to understand how it functions in a non-invasive manner. Whereas for the brain, you will find that electroencephalograms, EEG signals, they are there, and if you place some electrodes over the scalp of your head, you will be able to take up some signals from there, and if you analyze, you will be able to understand the brain activity over there. However, for getting the signal from the spinal cord, we need to have some invasive electrodes which pierces into the body, and they get up to the spinal cord, and you can get the signal from there. However, there are various problems over there also. You need a specialized medical person who can take the signal from there, because a slight damage to the spinal cord will affect the human physiological ability of the person. Okay, you might have seen in many cases where there are accidents and that affect the spinal cord, that may lead the person paralyzed. Maybe they're weighed down, their spinal cord system is not working, and weighed down, the person is having paralyzed, and they're onto the wheelchair. So like this. So spinal cord, it is a very deadly organ. If proper care is not taken, even a slight damage, it can lead to the paralysis of the thing. This is because even though we are talking about the brain and all these things, if you see the information to the different organs, they are mainly going through the spinal cord. Okay, the signal, they are being generated in the brain, but they are being transmitted to the different organs through the spinal cord only. Also, if you look, if you have some sudden activity, suppose you are going on a street and someone throws a ball or something towards you, and you take a decisive action. Okay, so who sends the signal? It is the spinal cord who sends the signal to give you some so that you generate some evasive actions to take care of the threat which is coming towards you. Okay, now in the brain, from the brain signals, we can analyze the cognitive activities of the brain. Okay, and we have said that coffee, it is a neurostimulant, and since it is a neurostimulant, it will definitely be reflected in the cognitive ability of the persons. Okay, so hence what happens is that if you take any neurostimulant including the coffee which contains caffeine, it may alter the cognitive performance of the volunteer. Okay, now in the second loop, we have the peripheral nervous system. Now, this peripheral nervous system, it is also consisted of two parts, the autonomic nervous system and the sensorosomatic nervous systems. Okay. Now, the autonomic nervous system, it consists of sympathetic nervous system and parasympathetic nervous system. Okay. Now, these two systems, sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system, they work in tandem. Okay, they work in tandem and they try to maintain a balance within our human body. The balance is a important thing. Okay, so if you see, previously we have discussed, suppose when you are running, your body temperature may get up and you may have a higher body temperature. Okay, but if you sit down for some moments, the body temperature will come down to a lower level or a basal level. Okay, so who is maintaining this? So when you are running, the heart rate should be increased, and when you are sitting down, it is coming down to the basal level. So someone is maintaining this thing. So who is that? It is basically the combination of the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system, which falls under the category of the autonomic nervous system. So we can say the autonomic nervous system, it is playing a balance of the different organs of our body through the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous systems. Okay. Similarly, if you look into the heart rate, when we run, our heart rate increases. When we sit down, after a certain period of time, it comes down to a basal level. Okay. So, this autonomic nervous system, it is being innervated to the different organs, and this innervation, it helps in maintaining the balance of the functioning of the organs within the human body. Okay, are you getting my point? Now, if you look into the different organs, they are deep seated, and getting the signal from there, it would be difficult. However, the analysis of the autonomic nervous system, the autonomic nervous system can be performed using cardiac physiology. Using cardiac physiology. Okay. So how it is done? If you look into the ECG, as I said, the autonomic nervous system, it is basically maintaining a balance of the cardiac system. And from the cardiac system, you generate the ECG, right? Now, when you generate the, if you get the ECG, and if there is a dynamic balance which is going on, then there will be changes at the at a smaller level also, smaller level of time also, right? Now, if you look into stretching the rope towards each other, so you have a group and B group of persons. They are trying to pull the ropes towards each other. Okay, so what happens? Do you find that the A group will continuously or in a same go, it will get the rope to himself, to themselves, or the group B can pull the rope towards themselves? No, it is not so. So before they fail, one of the group fails, sometimes this rope will go towards B and sometimes it will go towards A. So that means initially they are what they are doing, you are starting at a midpoint and they are initially trying to bring the rope to the midpoint level. Okay, that means they are trying to maintain a balance. Sometimes the balance will be towards B, sometimes the balance will be towards A. So the same thing happens over here also. Sometimes the balance shifts to the sympathetic nervous system, sometimes the balance shifts to the parasympathetic nervous system. And when that happens, there will be changes in the cardiac physiology, and that changes in the cardiac physiology will also be reflected over the ECG signals, right? Now you would say, sir, ECG is a very repetitive signal, okay? So they should repeat. The basic funda over here is that if you talk about a general person or a layman from a layman's perspective, you can say that ECG is repetitive. Okay, but at various time of our class, we have discussed that ECG is not repetitive. If it would have been repetitive in nature, when you would have run, the heart would not have what you call, the heart rate would not have gone higher. Okay, so that is not repetitive. There are some changes. There are some, what you call, some chaos within the repetition itself. Okay, to a certain extent, it is true that ECG signals are repetitive, but there are also chaos. There is dynamicity, and that dynamicity, it is basically coming from the sympathetic nervous system and the parasympathetic nervous system. Okay, now when you are having this dynamicity, so as I said, at a smaller time scale also, it should be reflected. Okay, now using the ECG signals, since the what you call recording of the ECG signal is very easy, you place some electrodes over the body, okay, and you will be able to get the electrical activity of the heart. So once you get this electrical activity, you will be able to analyze not only the cardiac physiology, which the doctors do from the ECG signals, but you can also analyze the heart rate variability. Okay, so if you see, we are talking about heart rate variability. I'm sorry. So we are not talking about heart rate. We are talking about heart rate variability. Okay. So what does this mean? How the heart rate is changing over time. We are not talking about heart rate. We are talking about heart rate variability. When we talk about heart rate, basically, what we are talking about, we are talking that the heart is beating in a non or heart is functioning in a non-dynamic way. Okay, but that is not the true case. If you see, if you measure the heart rate, what do you do? You measure the heart rate for, say, you measure the number of beats per unit of time, say for 1 minute or 30 seconds, you measure and then you calculate beats per minute. You are taking an average. Okay? You are taking an average. That is not a permanent number. Suppose for the first minute your heart rate is 79, the next moment it can be 81 also. And the next minute it can be 80 also. Okay? So if you look into the median value is 80 beats per minute. But that does not tell you that your heart rate is 80 beats per minute, because when you say that my heart rate is 80 beats per minute, you're taking out from the equation the variability which is happening within your body. Okay, and that are being what you call controlled by this sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous systems. Okay, so from this chart, if you look, we are talking about cognitive performance when we take coffee, okay, and that can provide us information about the changes in the central nervous system, where which part of the brain it is being affected, because we are studying the central nervous system through the analysis of the brain signals. Okay, then in the second part we can go for the analysis of the cardiac physiology. It will not only allow you to understand the cardiac physiology, but it will also allow you to understand the ANS activity due to the consumption of the coffee. Okay, so anyone having any problem up to this, because this forms the basis of why you do the analysis. If you have any question, please ask, you may ask now, because as we will go into the other sections, and if you are not able to recall this chart, it will be difficult for you.
सर।
सो व्हाट इंफॉर्मेशन डिड वी हैव फ्रॉम द प्रीवियस लिटरेचर? द प्रीवियस लिटरेचर इट गेव मिक्स्ड रिजल्ट्स ऑन द इफेक्ट ऑफ द कैफिनेटेड कॉफी ऑन हार्ट फिजियोलॉजी. ओके, एंड इट मेक्स द रिजल्ट्स वट एवर हैज बीन ऑब्टेन्ड ए डिबेटेबल वन. ओके, देन देर आर इन द लिटरेचर देर आर कॉन्ट्राडिक्टरी रिजल्ट्स ऑन द एक्टिवेशन ऑफ द एएनएस एक्टिविटी आफ्टर कैफीन इनटेक. फर्दर, वेरी फ्यू रिसर्च हैज बीन फोकस्ड ऑन द इफेक्ट ऑफ कैफिनेटेड कॉफी ऑन द ह्यूमन फिजियोलॉजी. ओके, लास्टली वी फाउंड दैट देयर वर नो स्टडी दैट प्रपोज्ड एन एआई, एआई मीन्स आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस बेस्ड क्लासिफिकेशन एंड एनालिसिस of the human physiological parameters that can differentiate the two groups. Now, why we want to do the differentiation this analysis? Because when we talk about the differentiation of the two states, pre and the post state, it can allow us to understand whether there are any significant changes within the physiology or not. Okay? Whether there are any significant changes in the physiology due to that stimulus, okay, and that can tell you or that can divulge detailed information about the alteration in the physiology of the person, okay. So till now, what Vikas has done. So we have already discussed that we have coffee as the stimulant. Okay, now because is mainly concentrating on the ANS and the cardiac physiology, and as I told you, the cognitive activities, it was being analyzed, it has been analyzed by one of my previous student, Kishore Taravdar. Okay, now in ANS and cardiac physiology, what it is, what Vikas has done, he has recorded signals, ECG signals, prior and post consumption of coffee. So prior is group B and post consumption is group A. Okay. So from there, he has extracted RR interval signals. Okay. I will go come to the RR interval signals. What are RR interval signals later on? So after the extraction of the RR interval signals, he went for HRV parameters. HRV parameters means heart rate variability, and the statistical parameters associated with heart rate variability we call it HRV parameters. Okay. Now, once you get this parameter, so you have a pre and post condition. Okay, so you apply some statistical techniques and you can find out the significant features from there. Okay, now once you have find out the significant features from there, you can then go for the evaluation of the changes in the physiological parameters based on the previous what you call previous observations. Okay, so say for example some A stimulant, it increases this heart rate variability. Okay, so you can from there you can say, okay, if this parameter is increased, then the heart rate variability is increased. If that parameter is reduced, that then the heart rate variability is reduced. Okay, or some another parameter, If it is increased, that means sympathetic activity is increased. If there is another parameter which is increased, that means the parasympathetic activity is increased. Okay, or there is another parameter which is LF by HF ratio, which will be coming later on. If that is increased or decreased, this LF by HF ratio, it provides you information about the balance between the systematic sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system. Okay, so the balance of the autonomic nervous system, it can be analyzed by analyzing the HRV parameters like LF by HF ratio. Okay, so this is how we can go for the analysis of the autonomic nervous system. Then, since we are directly taking ECG signal, we can go for the direct ECG signal analysis. So for that, we can take 5 seconds of the signal, okay? And then initially, again, there are two parts. In the first part, you can go for the extraction of the statistical and entropy based features, and then you can go for the significant feature extraction, and then you can go for the performance evaluation. Performance evaluation of what? Of the this machine learning models or AI based models. Okay. So over here, the analysis is directly done on the ECG signals. Again, if you want, you can analyze or decompose the signal using various signal decomposition techniques that includes discrete wavelet transform and wavelet packet decomposition. So these are just the examples. Okay, these are just the examples, right? Now, from once you have decomposed, that means what I want to say over here, if you remember in our last class, I have talked that when you are analyzing the ECG signals, when you go for the decomposition, say you have S, from this S, you can get S1, S2, S3, S4 and so on you may have. If you combine all these four signal components, you will be getting back the signal S. Okay. However, if you look into the signal S1, it will be having a specific bandwidth. If you consider S2, it will be having a specific bandwidth. If you consider S3, it will be having a specific bandwidth. If you consider S4, it will be having specific bandwidth. But if you add up all of these, you'll be having the combined bandwidth of SW. Oh, sorry, S. Combined bandwidth of S. That means the S and this combination of S1, S2, S3, S4, they are same, which we called S dash in our last class. Okay. So the S and S dash will be the same. So what you can do, you can find out all of these the parameters, statistical parameters from all of these sub signals, okay, which you have used. Excuse me. Since you have decomposed the signal into different sub components, the process is called decomposition. And discrete wavelet transform and wavelet packet decomposition, these are one of the two of the common techniques to decompose a signal. There are other methods which I will not discuss today, okay, which is out of the scope of this lecture. Over there also you can go for the decomposition of the signals into various subcomponents. Okay, now once you have got these subcomponents, you can extract the statistical and the entropy based features from these subcomponents. Okay, And from there, you can try to figure out what are the significant features, okay, by the statistical means, and then you can go for the performance evaluation of the artificial intelligence techniques, whatever you want to analyze. Okay. In the last case, we have the cognitive function. So over here, the EEG recordings are made prior and post consumption of coffee. Okay. From here, the recording of the EEG data in the presence of cognitive stars or external stimuli, they are being made. Okay. And what is the external stimulus? In this case, we are having two stimulus. The first one is the caffeinated coffee and the second is the photic stimuli. What do you mean by photic? Photic means light signals. Okay. Now from there, you can compare the individual task performance before and after the consumption of the coffee. Okay. So coffee is the primary stimulant, which will stimulate the central nervous system, and then we will be giving a secondary stimulant, which is the which will allow us to understand the cognitive performance. Okay. And in this case, what I told, we used photic stimuli. Okay. Now once you have done the comparison, then you can go further tracking the changes in the different brain regions. Okay. Now, study of the ANS physiology. So ECG, I have already told you, it is a graphical representation of the electrical activity of the heart. For our study, 15 healthy and sedentary male volunteers were selected. Now, even from the sedentary group, we have selected volunteers who do not consume alcohol, cigarettes. Okay. Even if they consume, they do not consume regularly. Okay. So why these are important? If you look, both alcohol and cigarettes, they are also known CNS stimulants, right? Alcohol also, it can stimulate the CNS. Cigarettes also, it can stimulate the CNS. Okay. So if you have some volunteers who are already having or who are under the influence of the alcohol and cigarettes for a longer period of time, then what will happen? The stimulation which has been generated due to these neurostimulants, they will affect the analysis. Okay. So when you are doing any biological analysis, you have to understand whatever the measure you want to analyze, that measure should not be affected by the other parameters. Okay. Like his fooding habits, it's his lifestyle. Okay. Yeah, another thing, why we have taken sedentary? Why? Sedentary means they will not do any physical activity. They will mainly be involved with the computer type works, or they will be involved with the studying and all these things. They will know, they will not go for the physical activities like swimming, running and all these things. Why? If you look into the cardiac physiology of an athlete, if they run for 1 kilometer and if you run the same distance, you will find the heart rate of the athlete, it will come down to the normogenic condition pretty quickly as compared to yours, because their autonomic nervous system, it gets trained. Are you getting my point? So we had selected a sedentary group of volunteers. Okay, another important thing over here is male. Okay, why male? Why we did not included the female volunteers? If you look into the physiology of the male and the female or the female body, the physiology is totally different. Okay, the women, they have a very dynamic physiology. Why? Because they undergo through the process of ovulation. Okay, so what happens over there during the ovulation process, the amount of hormones in their body, they are constantly changing. Okay, now if they are constantly changing, suppose on a particular day, say for example, I have called all the persons on a particular day for the recording of the ECG. So the ovulation process, they can be broken down into three stages. Okay, so someone may be in the stage 1, someone may be in the stage 2, someone may be in the stage 3. Now in either, if someone is in the stage 1 of the ovulation process, then what happens? Their hormonal balance will be different. If someone is in the second stage of the ovulation cycle, their hormonal stage will be different. And someone, if they are in the stage 3, their hormonal composition is totally changed. And this hormonal, since the hormonal activities are changed or hormonal concentrations will be changed within the body, what will happen is that it would also affect the autonomic nervous system in a differential manner. So when you are starting, you are already starting with a biased results. Not biased, mixed results. Okay, so you want to eliminate those things. So due to this reason, what we did is that we chose only volunteers, especially the male volunteers. Okay, one of the ways to understand the activity of the differential changes in the activity of the female volunteers is to fix up a specific day depending upon the ovulation cycle of the female volunteers. Say for example, day 1 of the ovulation, okay, or day 0 of the ovulation, okay, so, or the day 5 of the ovulation. So you fix up a day, and it is only the female who will know what is the day of their ovulation stage. And if they are willing to help you out, then only you can go for the analysis of the physiological signals for the female volunteers. Otherwise it becomes quite difficult, especially in Indian scenario. We have found that not many females, they are very free because of the social stigma what we have in the Indian society. Many female volunteers, they are not very free to divulge their personal information and all these things. So in India, it is very difficult to work with the female volunteers as compared to the Western countries, where the social stigma is not that, they have an open-minded thing, more open-minded or open this thing. So it's because of the type of education they have been imparted with. Okay, that is there. So because of that, in India, when you work with the physiological signals, working with the male volunteers, it becomes quite easy. Okay, now once you have selected the volunteers, you have to first verbally inform them about the study. Now, after they have been informed, you have to get a written consent from them whether they want to participate in the study. Okay, this is an important thing. If you do not get the written consent, then you are not allowed to work with the signal of the volunteer. Okay, there are volunteers who do not want to sign it depends on them. So, no, I will not give. And even there are many volunteers who would say who are afraid of giving the signals. Okay, so and the afraid comes, okay, if you use my signal and if what do you call, if I have any diseases, it will come out. So it is not like that. Okay, so what we are doing, we are just looking into the activity of some this thing. And even if there is some problem with someone's signal, that basically helps the person to understand, to get the treatment at an early stage. But in India, you will find many of the persons, they will say, no, I do not have any problem. If you do the analysis, I may get the problem. I have seen various persons who are having, who may have diabetes. They do not go to the doctor and get their blood sugar level test, saying, no, if I go to the doctor, if I get the diabetes, then I will be under restrictions. But the thing is that if you have the diabetes and if you get it checked, then it is better for you only, because diabetes, in diabetes you have high sugar levels, and if you have very high sugar levels within the body, then it will slowly damage your heart, not only heart, the kidneys, whatever the organs you talk about. So you are doing a harm to your body. So that social stigma is also there. Okay, so what you have to do is that you have to get you have to inform them verbally about what you want to do with their signal, and then you have to make them sign a you have to get a written consent from them to record that they want to participate in the study. Okay, so in our case, because we went for the ECG signal recording for 5 minutes in lead one configuration. Okay. The sampling frequency of the recording was maintained at 1 kilohertz. Okay. Now I think time is over. So we will continue in the next class.